Hello, everyone, and welcome to Unit 4. Mrs. Roper and I are excited to begin this new journey in which we leave behind the poetry of Whitman and Dickinson, and we begin to focus on the Reconstruction and the boom of America following the Civil War. Take out a piece of paper and something to write with. Remember, you will need to take notes on all of the introductory information, as it will appear in many forms throughout the unit and on the unit test. Let's start with two popular forms of entertainment. First up is a movie. And next we have a TV show. What's the title of each one? What are they about? Who is the main character, the hero, so to speak, of each of the texts? I want you to go further and think about how this would relate to the literary, canonical work of literature. What are the significant differences between the hero of each and the themes of each text? What are those differences? The Avengers is a model of the romantic hero. In that movie, we have the young, innocent person who avoids city life, seeks higher truth in nature. And in the TV show The Office, we see a representation of realism's sarcastic look at the ordinary life, and the hero has changed from one of romantic notions to one of realistic notions. In this case, a hero can be more experienced and worldly, cunning, faces reality as the inevitable truth of life. The major event that shapes this period of time is the reaction to the Civil War. During this time, technology increased and the access to information began to flow. Writers grew tired of out-of-touch romantic style of writing, and they returned to a realistic view that focused on ordinary people and ordinary lives. Now what I'd like you to do is take a look at this piece of art that I'll display for you. As you look at this piece of art, write down three things that you would use to describe what you see. Now take a look at this piece of art and do the same thing. Write down at least three things that you notice and explain what you see. What did you notice that was the same, and what did you notice that was different between the two images? Can you understand the difference between the image on the left and the image on the right? When we look at realism, we want to look at how the world is portrayed in our everyday life. On the left, the painting is an example of romanticism, and on the right, the painting is an example of realism. Do you see the subtle differences? Look at the colors. Look at the saturation of the faces. Look at the subject. The subject moves from being centered on a natural image to one that is centered on a human image. With the Civil War ending and the passing of the 13th Amendment, which abolished slavery, the political climate began to shift. There was a shift also from the agrarian society to a more urban life in industrialized cities. Problems of overcrowding, sanitation, and working conditions began to emerge. So what are the terms that you will need to know for this unit of study? Well, there's three branches of realism that you need to be familiar with. The first of them is realism itself. Realism is defined as the contrast between idealistic look at the world. And in the realistic world, they attempt through the authors to represent familiar things as they really are. Authors chose to depict everyday and what seemingly would be boring activities and experiences instead of using the romanticized versions of a life that none of us actually lead. The next branch of realism that you need to be familiar with contains two terms, that of regionalism and local color. And when we talk about a definite definition of regionalism, we talk about how local color is used within fiction and poetry, and it focuses on characters, dialects, customs, the topography of the land, and other features that are specific to a given region. And in the United States, we have five different regions in which this takes place. We have the Northeast, we have the South, we have the Midwest, Southwest, and the West. Setting is hugely important within regionalism. It emphasizes frequently on nature and its limitations that it opposes, given the topography of the region. Settings are frequently remote and inaccessible. The setting is integral to the story and may sometimes become a character in it of itself. Think of the Mississippi River here. You'll see that focus a lot through Mark Twain when we read his text. Characters are also of importance. Local color stories tend to be concerned with the character of the district or region rather than with the individual. Characters may become character types, sometimes quaint or stereotypical. The characters are marked by their adherence to the old ways, by dialect, and by particular personality traits central to the region. In women's local color fiction, the heroines are often unmarried women or young girls. The narrator is typically an educated observer from the world beyond who learns something from the characters while preserving a sometimes sympathetic, sometimes ironic distance from them. The narrator serves as mediator between the rural folk of the tale and the urban audience to whom the tale is directed. It has been said that nothing happens in local color stories by women authors, and often very little does happen. Stories may include lots of storytelling and revolve around the community and its rituals. Many local color stories share an antipathy to change and a certain degree of nostalgia for an always past golden age. A celebration of community and acceptance in the face of adversity characterizes local color fiction. Thematic tension or conflict between urban ways and old-fashioned rural values is often symbolized by the intrusion of an outsider or interloper who seeks something from the community. The final branch of realism that you need to be familiar with is naturalism. And naturalism is generally one that stumps students, so pay particular attention to this definition. The literary periods are often confused with one another because they are very similar in that they both portray nature and human lives as faithfully as they possibly can. The realist, however, believes that people can choose their own direction in life and they make their own moral choices. The naturalist, on the other hand, believes that they cannot. Naturalists see human life determined by the hereditary and the environment in which they live. The individual is trapped in predestined lives that they cannot change, and the outcome is generally the worst-case scenario, perhaps even death. I often think of the realist as being someone that sees the glass as half full, and the naturalist as seeing the glass half empty. That concludes our introduction of realism, naturalism, and regionalism. Please remember that you can review this information at any time, as you will expect to see this in the upcoming weeks and, of course, on the unit test. Good luck, and I hope you enjoyed this period of literature.